What is under assault right now, and I feel strong about this, is an assault far greater than Osama bin Laden ever could be. And the assault is upon Americans' native intelligence and sense of decency. The native intelligence of the ordinary person, so-called. A phrase I don't like because there's a patronizing touch to it. But the non-celebrated person and a sense of basic decency in them. And that's what's under assault now more than ever.
I remember the first time I encountered Studs Terkel's early classic, Working. Within minutes, I fell into its vivid world of unvarnished voices recounting what they did for a living and how they felt about what they had to do. A prostitute, a shoeshine boy, a CEO, a panoply of American characters, salty, sweet, and sad, struggling to find meaning in often demeaning labor. And it was all refracted through Studs' garrulous voice and compassionate heart. How did he get people to bare their souls and tell him truths they discovered only as they spoke them? Over the next four decades, Studs went on to write a dozen more oral histories. Each has been a collection of indelible voices and unforgettable personalities, focusing on one or another great theme of American life. The prickly questions we often don't like to discuss, like race, class, and death, but also those we do, like the imperishability of hope. Studs is an old-fashioned, unapologetic liberal, in a time when it's been unfashionable to admit it. But his political convictions have never gotten in the way of his passion for people, whatever their politics or calling. He's even had a soft spot for the FBI agents who've come to investigate his unorthodox views. Today we'll visit Studs' place in a special edition of A World of Possibilities, Studs Terkel, A Heart as Big as the World. After four decades of admiring him from afar, several years ago I made the pilgrimage to his hometown, Chicago, to interview him about his life and work. He was 92 at the time. He arrived at the WFMT studios in his signature red-checked shirt, like a living, breathing Italian tablecloth. Under his arm, he packed half a dozen books of poetry, with slips of paper marking the poems he planned to read. Unlike my usual, more spontaneous style, I came prepared this time with a list of some 30 questions. 30 minutes later, he paused just long enough for me to wedge in my second question. It seemed like after a lifetime of listening, he was finally ready to just talk. A question about early influences elicited a flood of memories, both personal and political. Studs had spent an idiosyncratic life with unusual people, producing an unconventional view of American history. His American story is a history not of politics and high finance, but of scrappy social movements as seen and told from street level.
It's also influences. I mean, people you run into and meet play roles in your life. For example, Rosa Parks. She's a heroine. She is. Rosa Parks, the middle-aged lady, sat down, didn't get up off the bus to give that white standing man the seat that she had, and so the bus boycott began, and so began that great victory. Well, how did that happen to begin with? You know, there was a spontaneous, no, Rosa Parks was a remarkable woman, but she met a woman named Virginia Durr, a southern white woman, who's one of the, to whom I dedicate the book, she and her husband Cliff. She worked as a seamstress for Virginia Durr, and they talk about conditions. And Virginia suggested she attend Highlander Folk School in Tennessee. It's a school for adults organized, run by a man of a remarkable name named Miles Horton. And it was attacked by George Wallace, of course. And so she went to that school. And then she became a secretary to E.D. Nixon, the ex-Pullman car porter, who was head of the Montgomery NAACP. And so after that, by the way, this ex-Pullman car porter, E.D. Nixon, knew they were planning a boycott of the buses because of the way they were, you know, not to ride the buses. Most who rode the buses were black people. But he said, we needed another voice, not mine, because I'm not as educated as the others, so he's very eloquent. And so he who chose a young clergyman from Atlanta named Martin Luther King Jr. to come to Dexter Avenue Baptist Church and lead the bus boycott. And it's all led to coming from Rosa Parks sitting now, not spontaneous. So you see, there are influences, and that's a big factor. We do run into other people. Maybe some people do transform themselves, but basically it's somebody or some other or some circumstance that does it.
I'm really struck when you tell me that and by how much this kind of social change, as opposed to the change that comes from above, that's by dictate, comes from the frailest and most almost accidental meetings. For example, your whole career, it seems to me, was accidental.
Mine is accidental all the way.
It wasn't.
I mean,
it?
I didn't plan to be here. Why? I'm at the hotel, right, at Ben's Hotel, and I'm going to be a lawyer because, well, I heard of Clarence Darrow, the attorney for the damned, he was called, Clarence Darrow. And so I go to West Chicago Law School as a matter of course. I should have done something else. I don't know what, but the accidental is there were three bleak years for me. And the accident is going there not liking it and having that silly job in Washington. But then being on a project here, it wasn't the WPA, but it was a government project, although it wasn't the WPA writers' project. But all was happenstance. If I didn't meet this guy who was directing a theater group, this labor theater group to Waiting for Lefty, I might not have become an actor, see.
And if you hadn't met Andre Schifrin and Andre Schifrin hadn't said, why don't you do...
If I had met Andre Schifrin, it wasn't published in that magazine, I wouldn't... I did do a book on jazz years ago for kids, but that was nothing. But the oral histories was all because Andre had read something of mine. He went to Cambridge, Andre did. The same group that had Jonathan Miller going then, Peter Cook, and Eleanor Braun was an actress of group. And they had come to Chicago, a group called The Establishment, a comic group of which she was part. Second City went to London. It was an exchange. Interviewing her, she told him about the way she liked my interview, and he read this stuff in the magazine. If it weren't for Andre, I wouldn't be doing what I'm doing now. What would I be? Maybe I'd be a concierge at a hotel.
In his earlier life, Studs was an actor, both on stage and radio. He gravitated to music, and his tastes in tunes were as eclectic as his preferences for people. Classical, blues, jazz, folk. Through his radio show, Wax Museum, he came to know the musical giants of his time, including the incomparable gospel singer, Mahalia Jackson.
In the days before TV, I was doing a radio program called the Wax Museum. It was a pun on old recordings. And I'd play opera and symphony and jazz and folk. It was eclectic. And I played the record of a singer called Mahalia Jackson.
Sure.
I remember hearing her voice sing this one, Apollo 78, move on up a little higher. I never heard a voice like that. And so I played a lot of Mahalia records and got to know her and became friends. And now time passes. The blacklist and all, now it's a little, now it's 50. It's after Studs Place is off, and I'm doing that. Now things are easing off a bit. Mahalia is now internationally known. And CBS, the other was NBC. Now CBS is offering a radio show on the network. It's 7 o'clock, I forget the time, 7 Chicago time, 8 New York, with an audience, a studio audience, in the Wrigley Building. CBS studio is there, in which people attend a radio program. So they offer Mahalia the show, but she says, I'll do it and go and get it. And Studs Terkel is the host of the show. And they're a little aghast, you know. They saw all this stuff. And so she's, that's it. And so they agreed. And so we're doing the show. We're rehearsing about the third or fourth week of the show. Another guy comes in from New York from CBS on the stage. He's came from the wings. He's very polite. He says, would you sign this? It's just pro forma. And it's a loyalty oath. I mean, the guy comes on stage. It's a loyalty oath. I said, no, of course I won't sign it. I don't believe in that. And he said, well, you have to. And now, I'm worried about the audience going to come in half an hour. And Mahalia comes, she's passing by. She knew all about me. She used to say, Studs, you got such a big mouth, you should have been a preacher. She'd always say that. And she passes by, here's this argument. Is that what I think it is, baby? You know, that's the way she'd talk. I said, yeah. Are you going to sign it? I said, well, of course not. Well, okay, let's rehearse. She says, oh, Miss Jackson, Mr. Terkel has to, but this is from upstairs in New York. Well, she said, will you tell Mr. Upstairs in New York that if they fire Studs, they'll find another Mahalia. Do you know what happened? Nothing. The guy disappeared. And the program went on a schedule. So my prologue, you know, begins, Mahalia, in that bow jest, told us what America is all about and self-esteem.
From radio, Studs migrated to the new medium of TV. In its early, some say golden days, it was still a wide-open medium, with room even for eccentrics like Sid Caesar and Studs himself. For a time, he hosted Studs Plays in a top evening slot on NBC's Chicago affiliate.
Remember, TV was 6 to 10 at night, and it wasn't the powerful thing it is today commercially. It was in the hands of the director, the writer, the actor. And there were three shows in Chicago. Garraway at Large, and then he was wooed to go to New York, became the very first face ever seen on daytime TV, a program called Today. And then it was Kukla, Fran, and Ollie, by the genius of our group, Bert Tilstrom, who made little puppets come to life. The third was Studs Place. And all three had a common denominator. They were improvised, and there was sort of a freedom to it, and it was sort of live. And so I was hot. But suppose I didn't have a big mouth, as Mahalia said. You know, suppose I did shut up. I probably could have done one of those shows in New York, MC, falling off a log, for Christ's sake.
But my
wife said, you'd have been fired anyway. You know, damn well you'd have said something. I said, that's true, too. Or I'd have died of frustration. I mean, can I do what Baba Wawa does? For God's sake. Really,
this has been very fulfilling, hasn't it, for you? Tremendously fulfilling to do all these
things.
Yeah,
but it's all accidental. That's my point.
Yeah.
Any number of things could have happened.
Well, what do we know about how social change happens? To me, it seems to be a combination of high purpose and accident and opportunity.
I think all three play a role, as you've named. High purpose is the least. I think it's opportunity. I think it's accident and opportunity. And a certain connection, whether you know it or not, it's a connection with somebody else, whether antagonistic or affirmative. We don't live in vacuums.
Studs grew up hanging around the rough talk in the lobby of the Wells Grand, the anything but grand rooming house his mother ran in downtown Chicago. There he heard the stories of small-time crooks and con artists. Despite a wide-ranging intellect and a law degree from the University of Chicago, he enjoyed playing the gangster on radio. In reality, though, he cared far too much about his country to be a casual criminal. He violated only those laws he thought violated the spirit of the Constitution. And that often put him at odds with the powers that be.
Where did my influences come from? The hotel my mother ran. Father.
Right.
There were these guys, Wobblies against the Scissorbills. Scissorbills are guys who said the boss is right. He earned it. You wouldn't be there. And they were called capitalists with holes in their pockets by the Wobblies. And they'd argue back and forth, and it was exciting. Most guys didn't give a damn one way or the other, you know, but they enjoyed the entertainment. Otherwise, have some sour mash and go see the girls on Sunday. But that got me into these exciting meetings. Many of them were left. I wound up being a ham actor. A couple of years at the University of Chicago Law School, 3 years, most bleak years of my life. Because I was dreaming of Clarence Darrow and the Scissorbills and Wobblies. And instead I get corporate law and partnership and one thing or another. And so I became a gangster in radio soap operas.
Yeah, how did you get miscast like
that? Well, that's it. You see, I was on one of the projects, and there was a guy I always went to theater as a kid because the hotel, press agents in those days were free and easy. The hotel was near the Loop, but these guys never went to the theater. But it was near the Loop, so they put a sign up in the room. There was our lobby, and I'd get two free tickets. So I was a theater buff as a kid, and then got involved with the labor theater group. Didn't go into all that. Waiting for Lefty. But I became a gangster in radio soap opera show. And then TV comes along, out of the world of TV, and it was Chicago. It was new then. It was in the hands of the writers and producers. It wasn't the power. And Chicago had several shows. I mentioned one they called Studs Place.
Right, I remember that.
That John Crosby, preeminent critic, said is one of the three examples of what TV could be. I was hot property until things, McCarthy comes along, and I get a visitor from New York. And he sits there with all the solemn-faced executives. I'm hot property, except for one thing. It was common knowledge in the trade that I was engaged in all these activities. It was no secret. I would be a chair of a committee and I'd be on the picket line. I say, I never met a picket line I didn't like or a petition I didn't like. And they say, look, here's the petitions. Anti-lynching, anti-Jim Crow, friendship with the Soviet Union, who were allies. And did you sign these? I said, yeah. Well, don't you know they were sponsored by the communists? And that's when I said, I learned this march upon McLeish. I didn't say it, and I had a piece on it. Whatever they do, we do the opposite. Whatever we do, they do the opposite. So I said, suppose communists come out against cancer. Do we have to come out for cancer? And he said, that's not very funny, you know. I don't think it's very funny. And he's Queen Victoria, not amused, you know. Then he's a drill sergeant. He says, you got to stand up and be counted these days. So I stood up. He said, that's not funny either. Sit down. So I sat down. And finally, he said, it's the easy way out. What you can say is you were duped. You didn't mean it. That many people have done that. Say, you were a fool. The commies took advantage of you. I says, no. I demurred. So NBC decided to deem my services anymore. As a result of which, I had rough time, sort of, would pick up $100 or so at lectures, women's clubs, and jazz and folk music. But I was pursued by a local legionnaire named Ed Clamage, who has decided he's the Americanism Committee of the Legion. And with what I call railroad watch regularity, he'd send warning notes to all these women's clubs not to have me, because I was un-American. And every one of them turned him down, I appeared. But the one woman I remember, she was elderly and elegant. She was so offended by this quote-unquote vulgar bully that she doubled my fee to $200. So what did I do? I said, the most natural thing, I sent Clamage a $10 check. I said, because you have increased my fee by $100, I'll give you a 10% commission. You know what? He never responded to my note, nor even to the check. And so the thing is, this is in Chicago, you see. The report didn't make much of it. Were I in New York or Hollywood, I might have had a different fate, but my town, Chicago, is.
For the half century that Studs held forth about the world from a cigar smoke saturated office and studio on the seedy side of Chicago's Loop District, he felt right at home near both the high rises and the homeless.
My kind of town, Chicago, is my kind of town, Chicago is my kind of people too. People who smile at you, and each time I roam, Chicago is calling me home. Chicago. Why, I just...
This is a world of possibilities. We invite you to visit our website and explore the audio archives. Read about our guests and subscribe to the podcast. Find us at aworldofpossibilities.com.
Despite its fabled corruption, Chicago was and remains Studs kind of town. Even those locals who disagree with him politically often celebrate his earthy embrace of their town.
What I like is goofy humor, sense of humor. Chicago was a very corrupt city. Was, I say. Not that it isn't, but I mean, then, in the Elder Mayor Daley, the police was known. There was something called the Summerdale scandal, and that involved cops pointing out places to steal, and they'd guard them, and they'd get a color TV set or a fur coat for the wife, you know. So this is exposed. And so it becomes, so Elderman doesn't know, so he brings an O.W. Wilson, a criminologist in the West Coast, to take over. So people are laughing about this incredible, the corruption, you know. And so Nelson tells the story of Lost Balls to Huska. And Lost Balls to Huska, the bald-head ACs play $5 a man. They're playing baseball, softball, and it's $10 a man. And the team is tied, bottom half of the ninth inning, and they're up. Lost Ball is up, and he hits a ball. He hits a ball. The ball bounces somewhere, and the ball sort of disappears, and he gets the first base. Well, the first baseman, he's the winning run. First base looking for the ball, can't find it. So Lost Ball slides head first in the second base, dusts himself off because the second baseman's looking for the ball and can't find it. And he goes feet first in the third base. One head slide a game was enough. And he knows the third baseman's looking for the ball and can't find it. Now he's going to score the winning run because the catcher can't find the ball. Well, halfway home, he takes the ball out of his hip pocket. See, he picked it up. He throws it to the catcher, who tags him out, and they lose the game in overtime. And the guy says, so at him. So Nelson comes up to the guy at Lost Ball. He says, what in the world made you do that? What's that? To tip the mitt, to give that ball to the catcher, you'd have scored. You cost the guys $10 a piece, a lot of bones. You cost yourself $10. What made you take your ball out and toss the catcher to tag you out? He says, my conscience bothered me. Your conscience bothered you? Did your conscience bother you when you helped some of those cops and Richard Morrison, you know, steal all those stuff and everything? Oh, no, well, everybody does that.
With typical elan and irony, Studs even had the chutzpah to apply for work at the very agency that would later monitor his every movement.
I almost worked for the FBI as a fingerprint classifier. See, way back at the time I got that job, $12.60 a year to count baby buns, I didn't want to be a lawyer. You weren't working, so you'd read civil service openings and jobs, and one was fingerprint classifier, FBI. So I almost had the job. I was interviewed by Melvin Purvis in Chicago, head of the FBI. Melvin Purvis, the man who captured John Dillinger. And J. Edgar Hoover hated his guts because he got the publicity, and Hoover lived by publicity. And Melvin Purvis passed me, and I write letters longhanded, and so I got a letter from the director, called the director, a letter to the controller to put Louis Terkel, that's my L-O-U-I-S, on the payroll. And next thing you know, I got my civil service, I got my, years later, I got my dossier. There was a college professor, names crossed out, who said, no good, he's a low-down Jew, or something like it. He's low something. He dressed slovenly, and so next thing I know is canceled. So I wrote a letter to Hoover. I says, why am I canceled? I'm supposed to work for the FBI as a fingerprint classifier. So I lost those letters, and I was writing the director, and then a letter came back, form letter saying it's gone, it's over. So I could have done that, and so we're talking about the possibilities. I might have been a fingerprint classifier, FBI might have wound up CF. 10 now, maybe getting a civil service job, getting about $30,000 a year, $40,000 or something. Might have won. Oh, I've been kicked out anyway, of course.
Yeah, I think some things are inevitable.
Years ago, if I didn't get kicked out, if I weren't blacklisted, would I have done these books?
That's right.
See, now I'm not suggesting it is a good career move for young people. I'm not saying get blacklisted and things will happen to you. I'm not suggesting that.
And when the FBI came knocking, the ever-hospitable Studs threw the door open and greeted them with open arms.
When the FBI guys visited me during the home, my home, my wife, a social worker, very charming woman, was very cool to them. She says, you're not welcome here. But I'm an innkeeper's boy. My mother ran this hotel, so I'd welcome with overwhelming hospitality because, as against the Book of Luke in the Bible, there was always room at our inn, at the hotel, even for couples without baggage, you see, and even at my house, even for the FBI. And I always offered them double, triple martinis, which they all demurred. And for some reason, the FBI guys were very uncomfortable in the house. They sat on chairs like little boys, nervous, because my wife was cool to them. And I was thinking, how about a double martini, you know? And then I'd reach for Thomas Paine. And that's when they said, they better go. And so that was it. There's a Paine quote, you know, that I always carry with me. What's our country about? Thomas Paine in 1791. Thomas Paine was the eloquent voice of the American Revolution. Something new in the world. Never was anything like it. A cat can look at a king. A commoner can say no, go to hell, to royalty. And so a new government was born, the United States of America. And Paine was the one who was so admired by George Washington and by all the others. And in 17, by the way, Paine's Common Sense sold 150,000 copies. What was the population? 5 million at most?
Probably not even.
So it would be millions of copies today. Mm-hmm. He believed not just free Americans, free thinking Americans. And that's the big one. He assumed they were thinking. And this is Tom Paine. Listen, 1791. I'm going to read this. I was going to read this to the guys, but they left. What Archimedes, the Greek mathematician, said of the mechanical powers may be applied to reason and liberty. Had we, said Archimedes, a place to stand on, we might raise the world. The revolution in America presented in politics what was only theory and mathematics. Freedom had been hunted round the globe. Reason was considered rebellion, and the slavery of fear made men afraid to think, and italicized think. But such is the irresistible nature of truth that all it asks and all it wants is the liberty of appearing, of being heard. In such a situation, man becomes what he ought to be. He sees his species not with the inhuman idea of a natural enemy, but as kindred.
A species of kindred souls, none of them a stranger. Long before the interview from which this show is drawn, I was inspired by Studs to make my first pilgrimage to Chicago. My wife and I took Amtrak from Oakland, California, across the Rockies and the Northern Plains. As the track ties clicked away beneath us, I sat down day and night beside strangers in the carriages and club cars, tape deck in hand. I was doing research on public attitudes about nuclear weapons, and my intention was to record their responses to a single question. How do you feel about the bomb? Most had little to say about nuclear weapons. It wasn't something they thought about much. But they did think about the world, and it made them sad, mad, and often hopeless. The funny thing was that the chance to speak, and for once to be heard, did something remarkable for each and every one of them. They'd take hold of the tape recorder and speak into it as if speaking to their best friend, their inner soul, maybe God herself. And within an hour, even the most cynical and embittered soul would move through anger, bitterness, and despair to determination, hope, and renewal. When we reached Chicago, I called up Studs. He didn't know me from Adam, but he answered his phone. I told him what I discovered about the transformative power of listening. "How do you manage to get people to bare their souls to you?" I asked. "I don't interview them," he said. "We just have a conversation." It struck me then that no matter how much we speak, most of us seldom feel heard. The act of listening, as Studs has done both as a vocation and a passion for a lifetime, is a supreme gift, a rare act of healing and reconnection in a world of isolation and alienation. Coming up in the next half hour, why the media diminishes our sense of our abilities and downplays the basic decency of the ordinary person. "Don't ever give up on people," Studs once told me. "Just when you've given up hope, they often surprise you." I'm Mark Summer, and this is A World of Possibilities, distributed by Studs' own station, the WFMT Radio Network. This program is underwritten by listeners like you. Stay with us.
Riding on the city of New Orleans, Illinois Central, Monday morning rail. 15 cars and 15 restless riders, three conductors, 25 sacks of mail. All along the southbound Odyssey, the train pulls out at Kankakee, rolls along past houses, farms, and fields. Passing trains that have no names, freight yards full of old black men, and the graveyards of the rusted automobiles. And good night, America, how are you? Say, don't you know me? I'm your native son. I'm the train they call the city of New Orleans. I'll be gone 500 miles when the day is done.
This is a world of possibilities. If you wish to purchase a CD of this program, please write to info@aworldofpossibilities.com. This is the WFMT Radio Network.
This is a world of possibilities, and I'm Mark Summer. Author, raconteur, and American character Studs Terkel lives and breathes media. But in his ninth decade, he's troubled by the ease with which people are led by the media, as by politicians, to think and act against their own best interests.
There are more movements than I can count. There are so many. What is needed is an umbrella.
Mm-hmm.
You see, there are many movements. You start naming the labor movements. You start naming talk of a labor party and talk. Well, that itself is self-defeating in that each one has his own constituency without the umbrella. And once you have the umbrella, then you have something cooking.
And I think that there is more and more of an understanding
yeah.
that there aren't really any barriers between those, that
That's
they're
right.
all connected to
Greens,
one another.
Of course.
And when all the media cover these things, they say, well, the issues were all over the map. But actually, everyone is seeing the connections in a way that the media don't.
Not only that, there's something else about the American people. And it may not be the, maybe all people. There's a certain moment when they go either way, whoever gets to them, you see. I'll tell you a funny story. During the Vietnam War, Nelson Algren, my old friend, was at a church, a big church, debating a Vietnamese guy who was a stooge for the government, justifying the war. And Nelson was blasting him. Nelson finishes, he gets a standing ovation. And then this guy justifying the war got up, and he got a standing ovation from the same audience.
Mm-hmm.
I'm trying to say is, to get that now we have, here's where the odds are, here's where the cards are stacked. And that is that which is called the obscene joke, liberal media. Of course, it's a joke. We know the most powerful media mogul of the country is an Australian Neanderthal, politically who's become an American citizen, Rupert Murdoch. We know Fox Channel is a big one. We know Rupert Murdoch is ultra, ultra right. He's almost quasi-fascist in that sense. He makes no bones about it. What is under assault right now, and I feel strong about this, is an assault far greater than Osama bin Laden ever could be. And the assault is upon Americans' native intelligence and sense of decency. In all the books I've worked on, the premise, the subtext was always the native intelligence of the ordinary person, so-called. A phrase I don't like because there's a patronizing touch to it. But the non-celebrated person and a sense of basic decency in them. And that's what's under assault now more than ever.
For one who's seen more than enough in a lengthy lifetime to lose faith in Homo sapiens, Studs remains stubbornly hopeful. The title of his 2003 book, Hope Dies Last, says it all. And he sees that hope most of all in the young.
I find in the young, especially the high school young who took part spontaneously in different parts of the country, I find that day, February 15th, 2003, is the day of hope as 9/11 was the day of despair. That day, 10 million people the world wide, a million in the U.S., because 250,000 in New York, 150,000 in San Francisco, that's 400,000 right there. Doesn't name the small towns. See, people forget that took place not just in other cities, in small communities. And there were high school kids and college kids, and I think now they are ready. The 18-year vote is what it's about, you know, to... It's the idea is getting people out to vote. The important thing is less than half voted in the presidential election. No industrial country in the world, even third world countries, have greater turnouts. But we had less, so...
History, as it's recorded and taught to us, is mostly an account of and for the powerful. But in Studs' view, it's actually made by the anonymous many who shoulder the beams and tote the bales that build our societies and economies.
Hope has never trickled down. It has always sprung up. Even in the New Deal, city alliances were formed to fight the evicting bailiffs and push the furniture back in the house. Even in the New Deal, labor unions, headed by A. Philip Randolph, threatened to march on Washington unless the Fair Employment Practices Act was passed. And I say, even the New Deal, my wife reminded me, there was a nut who hopped onto a chandelier at a Waldorf Astoria luncheon of befuddled industrialists. It was the crash, and they didn't know what the hell hit them. You know, the crash, a Wall Street crash. The heading in the Variety magazine, which had raffish headlines, was Wall Street Lays an Egg, you know. And this guy leaps on a chandelier, swinging back and forth, crying out, Social Security. Well, they put him in psychiatric care, of course, but he served a purpose. I didn't know what it meant, but now I knew what it meant. You see, mm-hmm. when it mm-hmm. passed. So I'm saying, even in those days, something from the bottom up. Mm-hmm. And so it was in the 60s, something from the bottom up. And so people's sense of self-esteem is what it's all about in a free society. So Bertolt Brecht has a poem about that. It's from a folk opera called Three Penny Opera, written in pre-Hitler Germany. By Bertolt Brecht, he was the poet, and Kurt Weill was the composer. But he also was a poet as well as a playwright. So he says, who built Thebes of the seven gates? This is the question. In the books you will find the names of kings. Did kings haul up the lumps of rock? And Babylon, many times demolished, who raised it up so many times? In what houses of gold-glittering Lima did the builders live? Where, I like this one, where the evening that the Wall of China was finished did the masons go? For lunch, let's say. Great Rome is full of triumphal arches. Who erected them? Over whom did the Caesars triumph? Has Byzantium, much praised in song, only palaces for its inhabitants? Even in fabled Atlantis, the night the ocean engulfed it, the drowning still bawled for their slaves. The young Alexander conquered India. Was he alone? Caesar beat the Gauls. Did he not even have a cook with him? And here's the part I like best. Philip of Spain wept when his armada went down. Was he the only one to weep? Frederick II won the Seven Years' War. Who else won it? Every page of victory, who cooked the feast for the victors? Every 10 years, a great man. Who paid the bill? So many reports, so many questions. And so when I think of that reference to the Spanish Armada, were there no other tears? And so the history I like is history of those anonymous multi-millions down to the centuries who shed those other tears. They're the ones who built these things.
If we're born to hope and care, why, asks Studs, do we so often succumb to hate? Why do we so often support policies that bring more death than life? Stay with us.
Love, oh love, careless love. Love is love, careless love.
We invite you to visit our website and explore the audio archives, read about our guests, and subscribe to the podcast. Find us at aworldofpossibilities.com. This is the WFMT Radio Network.
See what love has done to me. Once I wore my apron low. Once I wore my apron low.
Studs has seen enough hatred and iniquity in his life to know and acknowledge the dark side of politics, technology, and human nature. But some part of him is still amazed and indignant at the misuse of human intelligence and possibilities.
We have, thanks to hatred and everything else, a technology that can knock us all off with one shot. And so you have that aspect. So here we are with an alternative. You can put it simply, life. Either be more attracted to life than to death. Are we a necrophilic society? That leads to another story, if I may. It's specific. It's when Ronald Reagan was elected president, his first act of office was to break the air controllers' strike, if you remember that.
Yeah.
The air controllers went on strike. In 1981, his very first major act was to break the strike and blacklist 11,000 seasoned air controllers. Now, let's go back. The air controller we know, we read about, has within his hands, her hands, the fate of thousands of passengers each day. And we've read of near misses because of air controllers' nervous breakdowns, because of air controllers losing control, tiredness, all that. The strike was about what? Oh, we should point out, he broke the union, Ronald Reagan did, that voted overwhelmingly for Ronald Reagan. It was a conservative union, voted overwhelmingly. And what were they striking about? It wasn't better wages. It wasn't that. They were striking for better conditions, for more health care benefits, for recovery at nervous breakdown places. They would striking for passenger safety. And 80% of America applauded Ronald Reagan. 4 to 5 says, you did it. You showed them. So then I start thinking, have we become a necrophilic nation? Do we court death more than life? I mean, are we more attracted to death rather than to life? The very fact that 4 to 5 Americans applauded for breaking the air and blacklisting 11,000 seasoned air controllers, because often the lines would say about a near miss, unseasoned air controllers, some of the management taking over air controlling. So it's this sort of stuff that is there. You have to re-ask yourself the question, are you more attracted to death rather than life? I would put it that way. Mm-hmm. Do you really like death that much? Mm-hmm. I mean, were you that anxious about going to Iraq, were you? We did it. We did it, didn't we? Or what next? Where to, what next? That was an old Sandburg poem, The End of the People, Yes, which I call, should now be called The People, Perhaps, you know. But The People, Yes, is one line. Where to? People march with a great bundle of grief. Where to? What next? In this case, where to? What next? Iraq? North Korea? Where to? What the hell is going on here? Do you love it that much? Or is it something else?
Studs was especially moved by a story about an ex-Ku Klux Klan member who joined a black woman he had once opposed in support of a janitor's union. For him, it demonstrates both the destructive power of hatred and the redemptive power of mutual forgiveness.
It says, ex-Grand Dragon, ex-Kliegel of Ku Klux Klan joins black woman in trip across the country to organize janitors in unions. I said, I gotta meet this guy. So I work with him. He's in Durham, North Carolina, where Duke University is. So we're sitting around, and it's a story, the classic story of a poor white whose luck is so bad. It's the book of Job. He fails at a milk route, fails at a gas station. They got a 50-gallon tank at their trailer house. He can buy 1 gallon a week, barely. And he has a drip, drip, drip on the tank. That's his life. Who's to blame? The nigger. It's been taught that all his life, the nigger. And so he joins the Klan. And he's now, you have to understand this mind of this poor white. They put that white robe on me and the hood, and I'm walking down initiation, a dimly lit hall, about 300 people, to that illuminated cross. I felt like I was somebody. And then as soon as he says that phrase, your mind explodes. That's the exact words used by Jesse Jackson when he talks to Operation Push in Chicago. Jesse says, you are somebody to the people there, to give them a sense of self-esteem. This guy wants somebody at the expense of somebody else, the blacks. But nonetheless, he felt that. And now it's civil rights time. It's the 60s. And there is one person in that town whom he loathes and despises as she does him. Mutual loathing. Her name is Ann Atwater, a large African-American woman who's always ill, but always leads the picket lines. Now they're having picket lines to try to make the Durham department stores hire black clerks. And who breaks up the picket line? C.P. Ellis, some young thugs he has. And it's bloody. They almost were killings. And now it's Jimmy Carter time. And a couple of $1 million goes from H.E.W., from the government, to the Durham public school system for something called charrettes, libraries or something. Now what's going to be done with that $2 million? So a meeting is called. Now, the schools are segregated, but the school board, for some reason, is integrated. And a black member of the board, Howard Clements, of the oldest insurance family, African-American insurance family in the country, is there. And he or some other guy, another black guy, has an idea. Let us invite every parent of every kid attending every public school in Durham. So they invite the Ku Klux Klan as well as NAACP. They invite the White Citizens Council as well as SNCC. What's a crazy idea? And C.P. Ellis says, I'm going to go to that. And he says, you're going to go with them? Yeah, because she, Ann Atwater, she's got a girl going to that school. I got a boy going to school. He's going to be represented by her. Who's going to represent my boy? So I got to go there. So they have a gathering. Each one gets up to talk, and of course they're at each other. He tells his story. He tells hers. It's pandemonium. Then one black guy gets up and says, you know, I think C.P. Ellis is a very honest man. I think he's an honest man. And C.P. Ellis saying to me, now it gets kind of funny as he's talking, says, what did he mean by that? He called me, this black guy called me an honest, what's he trying to do to my life, you know? And so next thing you know, someone says, we can't go on this way. We need a committee. I nominate, says somebody, Ann Atwater as chair. And the black guy says, I nominate C.P. Ellis as co-chair. Now they both look at each other. They can't, what the hell is this? They finally agree. She's got a girl that's got a boy to school. No shake hands, but they're going to do it. Now, as he's telling me the story, and I am listening, something is happening to him. And then one day, Ann comes in a-crying. What you crying about, Ann? Well, my little girl at the black school, buked and scorned by the black kids and the black teacher because her mother's going around with a Klansman. And I'm mocking her and laughing at her, and she comes in tears at home, and she's starting to cry, Ann is. And suddenly it hits me. My boy, same thing happens at the white school. White teacher's laughing at him and smacking him around and about because his father's going around with that black woman. Next thing you know, they're clinging to one another. They're in the same boat. Well, at that same time, he experienced little personal epiphanies. And now he gets a job as a custodian at Duke University, which is in Durham. Now, most of the custodian, which is janitorial work, are black. Overwhelmingly women, black women. He's one of the few white guys. He's there. But they're in the midst of an organizing campaign to start a union for janitors. And suddenly he realizes something. He's signing up more people than anybody. He says, hey, I'm good at this. I finally found my calling. I'm a union organizer. I'm going to run full time for this, for business agent of the region. And I'm not going to win because the black guy's my opponent, but I'm going to run anyway, because 80% black women. And so I get up to make my speech. I said, you know, the company is sending out the leaflets of me and my robe and all that. That was the past. They said, sit down. We don't want to hear you. Sit down. See, we know you. Sit down. So I figured, well, I'm going to lose. And then there's a long pause. I won, I forget the count, 354-20, something like that. They voted. They elected me. And then he says, those women, they knew me. They knew my heart. You know, me and them, we were at fifth grade education. He was getting his GED, I think. Fifth grade. The company sends down lawyers who went to Harvard and Yale. They try to break our union or try to force us. They negotiate with me and those women. We hold our own against them. They can't beat us, me and them women. We're something. Now I feel like I'm somebody. See, now that story to me is almost scriptural. It's power. It's about revelation and transcendence. And so that's the kind of stuff I like.
Yeah. For me, it's a real lesson to, I'm glad you're telling me this, because my tendency is to look for a movement that's composed primarily of people who are of like mind in this country and around the world. But what you're saying is, don't assume that anybody is outside that world. In fact, you're almost saying, like, you can't put anyone outside.
Just think of Nelson Algren debating that guy in that church. Both of them got standing ovations for saying the opposite thing.
When our interview concluded, Studs and I strolled down long corridors of immaculate new radio and TV studios where WFMT and its sister station WTTN are now housed. It's a far cry from the Loop location where Studs held court for half a century. His signature hat was crushed down on his balding head, and his arms pumped like locomotive wheel struts as he glanced from side to side. He seemed half amazed, half appalled at all the high-tech gear. Jesus Christ, he muttered, shaking his head. Looks like a German expressionist film. Except there's no Marlene Dietrich at the far end. Then we went to lunch. Sake, sushi, and salmon. A quintuple heart bypass wasn't about to slow this freight train. The indestructible Studs is bound for glory. And armed with humor and hope, he may just get there on time.
You said earlier that hope is what contrasts with hatred. Sometimes I think hope is not in itself quite sturdy enough, and that's why I wonder whether compassion is actually what we're looking for.
Well, because it's compassion, and I think you can't have compassion without hope. How could you have compassion unless you have despair? Lisa Mueller. Lisa Mueller is going blind now. She's a Chicago poet, and she is wonderful. And Lisa Mueller won a big prize called the Lilly Prize recently. And this is her on hope. And let's use the word for the moment, compassion, as a synonym for the moment. It hovers in dark corners before the lights are turned on. It shakes sleep from its eyes. Now, if you wake up in the morning, you know, and drops from mushroom gills. It explodes in the starry heads of dandelions turned sages. It sticks to the wings of green angels that sail from the tops of maples. It sprouts in each occluded eye of the many-eyed potato. It lives in each earthworm segment, surviving cruelty. It is the motion that runs from the eyes to the tail of a dog. It is the mouth that inflates the lungs of the child that has just been born. It is the singular gift we cannot destroy in ourselves, the argument that refutes death, the genius that invents the future, all we know of God. It is the serum that makes us swear not to betray one another. It is in this poem, trying to speak. You see, now, that shows how hope is natural. Hope is a natural child born, shouts, screams, yells.
I'm Mark Summer, and this has been A World of Possibilities. Thanks for listening.
You've been listening to A World of Possibilities with host Mark Summer. The senior producer is Greg McVicker. Associate producers Naima Didi and Matt Vidler. recording engineer Michael Schwartz. Thanks to the staff at WFMT, Steve Robinson, Terry Medina, Carol Martinez, and Eric Arunas. Special thanks to Gleb Ray Gorodesky of the Christensen Fund and Brian Walker of the Resilience Alliance. Theme song courtesy of Putumayo World Music. Other music courtesy of Polygram Records, Folkways Records, Red Pajamas Records, Sony Music, and Vanguard Records. I'm Gabriela Castellan. This is the WFMT Radio Network.